So initially we started with a group of about 5 students, just kind of, you know, back of the envelope calculations, a few simulations to figure out, can we really do this? Okay, I think we're about good to get started. Once we figured out we could, we brought about 30 students on board from the multidisciplinary design program. And so we're really pulling together all the talent that we have to try to get this thing built.
You take the idea of a time capsule, which is usually just buried in the ground or put somewhere in storage somewhere, and the idea of space, and you mix them together, and it's an innovative concept, I think.
The max power expected is around 25 watts.
The satellite.
The challenges right now is that there is not yet a CubeSat in space that has propulsion on it. So we are going to be one of the first, especially student built, to have propulsion on board.
This part, I guess the biggest part of the CubeSat, is the propulsion system. It's called a cat thruster, and it was developed by one of the professors at the university here. It's basically electric propulsion, and the propellant is water. It's just a lot of things that haven't been done before that we're trying to do as a student team. And the fact that we have the opportunity to do something like this, I think that's really exciting.
So we have the propulsion to put us in a legal orbit that will stay for 100 years. And then once this propulsion is done, we're going to turn the satellite into a passive satellite. And from this point on, it's not going to be transmitting anything. It's not going to be receiving anything. It's just going to be a floating block of U of M in space.
Since we want it in space for 100 years, we can't actively track it because electronics, nothing will like work for that long. So the retroreflectors are a method of passively tracking the system. We use the satellite ranging system to basically shoot lasers at it and get a signal back to see exactly where our CubeSat is.
It's not about people opening up a time capsule in 100 years from now. It's about us thinking about what is so important that we want to convey that information to people in the future.
Do you guys want your stories in space for 100 years?
So the biggest challenge at first was just finding people to be interviewed and making ourselves like heard on campus. Free donuts if you fill out our form, put your story into space.
We're collecting about 1,000 interviews from students, and we're going to put them onto a data chip and put it in a satellite and launch it into space to celebrate our 200th anniversary.
Hey, nice.
Yeah. So we're actually going to be etching these interviews onto a silicon chip that the Lurie Nanofabrication Lab creates. 1,000 interviews that tell personal stories about the university and about the students, about their life here.
They're hoping to store something like 2 gigabits per millimeter, something crazy.
Another part is going to be, we're going to have a DNA experiment on board. So we've been working on figuring out what can we get from the university, encode it in DNA, send it up into space, and then in 100 years we'll see just how much the DNA has degraded, if it's changed at all. And we're basically looking to see how viable is it to store information as DNA in space. This is real. Like, this isn't something that, you know, some company is just gonna stash away as a student project. This is something that's actually gonna be done, something that we can put our names on and be proud of. We can look up and say, it's really up there, it's really in space.
And the reason they're so small compared to typical weather satellites is because of the technique that they use to measure the winds. The science instrument on our satellites is really just a modified GPS receiver, just similar to the kind that's in your cell phone. Cygnus is a NASA satellite mission.